We move into the third segment of our inquiry as more of a learning from the entire discourse, the third segment being environmental adjudication. What has been the learning so far? And from here, how do we go about this entire aspect of justice? Let's take a quick look at the justice dispensation as is prevalent in India in retrospect. The Indian brand of environmental justice dispensation, as you have noticed and examined in great detail and depth, presents three distinct approaches with varying degrees of impact. The first one, of course, that which is delivered, the brand of the higher judiciary. This is something which is a trailblazer and a contributor to environmental jurisprudence, we have said earlier. It is always treated with the highest respect, and this has been full of innovations. It conceptualized rights, it cleared hurdles for access to justice in the processes and procedures. As you remember, the locus standi principle, how an ordinary member of the public could go to the court of law, even though he's not an interested party, bring in action in public interest over issues concerning environment, how it was facilitated by the higher judiciary, or even in the techniques developed in ensuring execution of its orders and compliance with its instructions. Cases, arguments, decision, wrap up. No, that's what we have seen. After the arguments are over, the findings are placed before the court. What does the court do? The court has issued orders and instructions, not the judgment in whole. A continuing mandamus getting issued. So a technique that's developed so that its orders are executed and compliance with its instructions are ensured without necessarily going through each time when once a judgment is given, there is a long lapse of time, and when nothing is done, the same party is going to the court all over again, starting the rigmarole process all over again. No. Look at the techniques adopted, the mechanisms brought into play, very innovative, out of the box. Imaginative interpretation and really, really application of constitutional provisions for securing justice. So everything done within the constitutional frame, although there has been imaginative out-of-the-box solutions provided, they have been able to very skillfully anchor it to some constitutional provision or a text spread over four decades in chronological terms. You can further reclassify this particular role of the higher judiciary, and it can be identified in the following phases of its engagement. Of course, when I say phases, 10 years, first 10 years, next 10 years, or the third 10 years, or anything like that, it is actually a bit of an overlap. And when I say 15 years, it is not exactly first 15 years. It may be more than 15 years. In some cases, it has even extended till the other day. But by and large, this is it. And there are overlaps. And one phase overlaps into the other phase. And there is nothing like, there is watertight compartments of, this is the period in which it happened. But it's predominantly that. And that's what I am bringing it to your attention. Look at the early phase, which is roughly around 15 years, right from around 1980 to 1995, if you put it like that, or up to 2000. Very activist, proactive, and the output is highly productive, and it contributed immensely to Indian environmental jurisprudence, and most of what I have said earlier is perfectly applicable to this phase. Comes the second phase, which is about a decade after the first one, for a period of about a decade, it created some space for paying particular attention to dealing with environment related cases. So some innovation in the form of setting up of green benches within courts or identifying a judge for a day-to-day handling of cases, or at least identifying one particular day and a judge to deal with only environmental cases. And through this particular process, with this innovation and over a period of time, the judiciary at the higher level catalyzed the central government to come up with a law and a host of laws to create special environmental courts. That is second phase, in which you have internal mechanisms for paying focused attention to environmental issues and then nudging the government to come up with special environmental courts. What the third phase? The last decade and a half, which we are still going through, the initial enthusiasm in transferring and referring environment related cases to the newly specialized bodies that were set in, and also displaying a bit of a judicial fatigue. You know, the judicial fatigue is such that if the same issue comes before the court of law over and over and over again, ad nauseam, the court would also feel a little uncomfortable, a lot circumspect, and may perhaps even think of losing interest. This happened. Look at the vehicular pollution cases. It started its life around 1984. 30 long years, the case is not over. Look at the Godavarman case, starting at 1993. Even to this day, the case is alive. We talk of Godavarman 1, Godavarman 2, Godavarman 3. Why? Because of continuing mandamus and so many orders and instructions issued. And you have a parallel administrative and adjudicatory mechanism created thereby, with the result that the courts have lost time, energy, effort, and skill is being put into one particular sector of governance. The court also felt that it's time that we should move on to other things. And by this time, the government should have come up with a host of laws, a robust mechanism, which would actually deal with environmental issues exclusively as a skilled professional would. And that is the stage we are in. Here you see rare display of judicial fatigue and transferring and referring environment related cases to these special bodies. This has happened. By and large, this has happened at the Supreme Court level. But high courts, it's a different ballgame. Although they have expressed resentment and unhappiness over that, they are reluctant to transfer cases which have substantial environmental issues, because high courts, as courts of original jurisdiction, they can admit any plea. And games are played by those parties who feel that they will lose out. If they go to the National Grid Tribunal, they invariably go to the high courts. We have seen that, and we have critiqued that also in the appropriate module that we discussed. And thereby, the courts also have started admitting appeals, started scrutinizing orders and decisions and approaches of these very special bodies, including that of NGT. And they passed their own orders, either in endorsement of these decisions given by the special bodies, are giving an altogether spin and an approach and conclusion, and whereby the real objective of environmental justice by specialized courts have taken a beating. Then what about the specialized bodies, the second feature of environmental justice delivery is by delivery by specialized bodies and NGT. It's a mixed bag. You know the formula evolved under Public Liability Insurance Act in 1991, as we have discussed, to assess environmental damage, a kind of a blueprint that was made available, and for awarding of compensation, which actually provided the template for more reasoned, weighted adjudication. That was the starting point. So it was very helpful to start with, and for well over 20 years it has been in operation, and even now it is certainly a good marker for the National Green Tribunal to work on. The National Environment Tribunal, there is a error here. It should read as the National Environment Tribunal that was created in 1995. As you know, it never took off. A specialized body, Law Commission report, the Supreme Court orders, and the retired Chief Justice preparing the draft, it never took off. So a law on paper never got translated into practice. Then what happened to the other specialized body, the National Appellate Authority, created in 1997? I think it had a fairly good innings to start with, an initial promise, and definitely noteworthy work. For a little over 3 years' time, it degenerated over time. We discussed that, reducing itself to an extension of environmental bureaucracy before petering out without even a whimper in its short-lived 13 years of existence. So that is the story about the developments between 1990 and 2010. Now comes an epoch-making event and a development, NGT, in 2010. It had a wobbly start for the first couple of years, but then it made up for the last time, and the next 6-7 years turned out to be an amazing entity. It came up with an amazing load of work that won lot of plaudits, but at the same time attracted adverse reactions in the last 8 years of its working. We have discussed the detail in that particular module, and the real concern, as we have expressed in the last module towards the end, ominous signs exist of this NGT for having done such great work, and for variety of reasons, as we have discussed that in detail, of it getting disowned, abandoned, and rendered redundant in the near future. Should that happen, then the entire process of seeking and securing justice through a specialized body, a professionally competent body, would be lost. A serious void would be created in the process of seeking and securing environmental justice. That should not happen, but there are enough signs of this becoming a reality. But then we have something very much within the existing body of the statutory frame, and we elaborately discussed it in the previous module, and that is the third feature of environmental adjudication in India: justice dispensation from within the statutory frame. Actually, this has been the design. Each and environmental legislation provided for this on paper, in clear way. But unfortunately, as we saw, the potential is not fully utilized. And as we know, the reasons are quite obvious, as put down in detail in the earlier module. Unfortunately, this aspect of an enforcer acting as an adjudicator as a quasi-judicial body is not given much importance by other agencies of state. In fact, its actions are challenged with vengeance by those against whom actions were initiated. And this is the most unfortunate part. Petitions by them are even entertained by the courts. I think there appears to be a serious lapse here of getting educated as to why they are there. Education both for the enforcer, the enforced, and the courts of law. Because you know, the statute makes it very clear. The legal status of the orders, instructions, and decisions of these specialized administrative agencies created under very special laws, they have the same status as that of a decree of a court of law. But the recognition is not very much there. Recognition not there, maybe because of ignorance, or maybe because of inconvenience, or may even be because of a kind of a jealousy that permeates in the whole system. Or maybe that those who have to render justice within the system do not have that capacity or competence because of certain internal problems of politicization, certain internal problems of non-creation of appellate bodies within the statute, and so justice remains a casualty on account of that. So there is a clear need of deepening this aspect, strengthening this third aspect, because you want a self-contained code of law. And one need have to really find solution from within. And that is for that reason all these environmental laws came into existence. And the need for strengthening this by all the concerned internally within these very institutions themselves, by the government and by other agencies of state, by way of support and higher judiciary's intervention. And that of the National Green Tribunal should become more of an exception. Don't entertain it every time. Don't make these forest administration, the wildlife administration, the biodiversity administration, the pollution control boards as your favorite whipping boy. Please try to consider them as someone who is sharing your responsibility of justice. Enable them, empower them, strengthen them, add reason to their decision making rather than sit in judgment over their orders and actions and make environmental justice a mockery. So this aspect needs to be strengthened by all the concerned in every possible way. This brings to almost to the fag end of our discourse. We are left with the last segment of the 12th module, and that's what we shall presently do, of doing a little bit of a final set of observations and a wrap-up. And that's what we presently do in the final segment.